Ever since we totally nailed sliced bread, humans have been trying to create the perfect cup of coffee. But why is it so hard? It's because there's a ton of complex chemistry involved. We all know and love coffee for the caffeine, but caffeine doesn't really affect its flavor. Making awesome tasting coffee requires excellence in three parts: the bean, the roast, and the brew. Let's break it down. Coffee farmers devote a lot of time and energy into growing and harvesting coffee trees. That's right, coffee does grow on trees. The bean is actually the pit of a coffee cherry. After these cherries get pitted, the bean is dried and processed. For the best tasting coffee, go for Arabica beans, since they have a higher taste quality and a wider variety of flavors and aromas. If you're looking for an extra jolt, Robusta beans have twice as much caffeine. Reactions pro tip here. Buy coffee in one-way valved bags that let gases out but don't let oxygen in, keeping coffee fresher longer. And because freshness is key, buy whole beans, not pre-ground, and use them ASAP. The longer the bean sits, the staler your brew will be. Fresh beans have lots and lots of compounds that determine how great your coffee tastes. Take chlorogenic acids. Once roasted, these acids react to form a variety of different products that all affect flavor and aroma, which brings us to... Roasting coffee beans draws out flavors like floral notes, chocolate, and more in a multi-step heat-related process. First, there's the Maillard reaction, which may be the world's most delicious chemical reaction. During this reaction, sugars and proteins react to form aroma and flavor compounds. Maillard chemistry is partially to thank for the great smelling, browning, and flavor of other foods like steak, fries, and of course, bacon. It also creates a lot of compounds in coffee, including 2-furfuryl-thiol, which gives coffee its delicious roasted flavor. As the temperature rises, sugar is caramelized and the generated compounds create butterscotch and burnt sugar flavors. At 205 degrees Celsius, the water inside the bean vaporizes, causing the bean to expand and crack open, what's known as the first crack in the coffee industry. Light roast coffees are taken out of the roaster after this first crack. Light roasts are higher in acidity, and the characteristics of different bean origins are most pronounced in light roasts, so that origin better be good. At 225 to 230 degrees Celsius, the bean cracks again, appropriately called the second crack. This crack results from the cellulose in the bean cell walls breaking apart. As it gets hotter, the bean turns a darker brown for that crowd-pleasing medium roast. Medium roasts create a coffee that has good balance between acidity from the bean and body from the roasting chemistry. Aromatic compounds that emerge give coffee an earthy scent and earthy roasted flavors. Even more heat will turn that bean darker and it'll become pretty oily. That's when you get a dark roast. By then, almost all the tasting notes are from the roasting. You can't really tell the bean origin at this point because a strong body overwhelms those geographic notes. Dark roasts are often used for espresso. So you've got all these choices lined up in bags on the shelf, but how do you actually brew the best coffee you can? And now we've arrived at the weakest link, the part too often left to us amateurs. So you've got a bean with a great origin story and a roast you prefer. Just grind it up and add hot water, right? Unfortunately, you can have the highest quality, most perfect roasted beans and still mess up the coffee. There are several key components. There's the coffee to water ratio. The pros say skip the tablespoon and get a scale. Then there's water quality. The flavor of the water will dramatically affect the flavor of your coffee, so the pros use filtered or bottled water. And there's the water temperature. Get it close to 96 degrees Celsius, but not over. Boiling water is too hot and you'll get gross burnt coffee. So now you've got to decide how to brew your coffee. There are Mr. Coffee's, percolators, pour-overs, French presses, and Chemexes. The basic principles of brewing methods are all the same. As you add water, it spreads across the grounds and CO2 bubbles out. Once the grounds are soaked, the extra hot water will dissolve compounds found in the bean's roasted cells. Most of the delicious compounds dissolve in water more readily than the nasty ones, so add enough water to get the good stuff to dissolve, but not so much that your coffee tastes gross. And finally, diffusion. Osmosis drags those compounds out of your coffee grounds and into the water, bringing those great flavors into your coffee pot. The pros will tell you that pour-over methods like a Chemex are better than automatic coffee makers. There's more control over things like how much water gets added and when, and pour-over methods continuously replenish the coffee grounds with fresh water, which makes the brew go faster. It's also an all-in-one stream instead of the showerhead-like contraption in your coffee maker. So, what's your preferred method to making your favorite cup of coffee? Or perhaps it comes down to what you add in your cup. I prefer my coffee with some whiskey and cream. Let us know how you like your coffee in the comments below, and as always, thanks for watching.